Good morning on this cold and frosty morning. Everyone coming in with snow on their hair. This is the time when we share announcements about congregational life. So if you have an announcement, please raise your hand and one of the ushers will bring you a microphone.
Hi, my name's John Mallory, and 14 years ago, I built a model of this church, a stick model of every piece of framing.
Keep the microphone.
Some of you might remember. I almost forgot myself, but I found the model and took a good look at it. It needs a few repairs. But I also found an article in the newspaper about it. And the chairman of the trustees at that point was, remember? Huh?
Peter?
No. Anyway, it's come to Norm Hill. And he had a great comment about having been up in the attic where I went to get the measurements. And the current chairman of the trustees and I built it in his shop just down Brazier Road. And it needs repairs. And it's also in great demand by those who are trying to get back to the beginning of the 200th anniversary. And I'm going to be going up there to take a closer look at details that I might have glossed over a bit. And I'm going to get the model fixed and get it out here so you can see it. And while you're sitting here, you can see the model and two men who are not here right now are heading up a committee to try to figure out how the church was built. So this model is going to be a great help to them and to me as I work with them. So that's all I have to say. Thanks. Bye.
Thank you, John.
Hi there. I just want to remind everyone that March 11th, we have the spiritual storytelling event coming up, sponsored by the Arts Ministry. And please bring an anecdote, a poem, a song that conveys how your spirit has been uplifted, amused, or changed by our church community. So it doesn't have to absolutely be something that happened here in the church, but something inspired by the church. We have a potluck at 6 o'clock, and then the moth-style event of the storytelling starts at 7. So please put on your thinking hats and join us on March 11th.
Thank you, Catherine. Yes, Deb.
Deb Reed, and I just wanted to let folks know that it's another soup pickup Sunday, and there is some extra soup available if anybody wants to make a purchase and bring home a quart. It's today after church, and it's called Liquid Energy Soup, a recipe donated by Heidi Tringe, and it's a lentil with sausage.
Diana.
I understand it's a very special day here for a very special member of our congregation. Happy birthday to Amy.
Hey. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Amy. Happy birthday to you.
Rona?
Yes.
Up here, I have a quick update on the 200 meal challenge. This is part of our 200 year anniversary of the church. We're challenging ourselves to make 200 meals to put in the freezers of the local food shelves. We're at 47, and that's in just a month's time. I was at the food shelf this past week, and people were awed and honored that people had done this cooking for them. They just said, "Wow, you're making food for us." So they were very pleased. I just want you to know that the work is appreciated, and we only have 153 more meals to go.
That's wonderful news, Kim. Thank you. Are there any other announcements? Then let's turn to June and I think Brent this morning for our prelude. Whether you are here in person or joining us online, welcome to our worship service this morning. In the uniqueness that is you, your ethnicity or race, your gender identity, your sexuality, your age, your spirituality, you bring the gift of who you are to this beloved community. We welcome you. We need you. We're glad you're here. And now please join in a few moments of silence to bring ourselves fully into God's presence. Please join now in our call to worship. We come in worship to God. We come to God who comes to us in Jesus. We come with our faith and with our doubts. We come as we are, because it is God who invites us to come.
In full.
Please join me in our prayer of invocation. We are here, God. We have wondered at your mystery in the stars, and we marvel that the maker of the universe knows us by name. We are here, Jesus. We have felt the warmth of your love, and we thank you that you have called us friends. We are here, Holy Spirit. We are grateful for your presence and for the way you comfort and challenge us. We are here, God, in this moment, in this place, and we thank you that you are here with us. Amen. I didn't quite know when I chose this hymn, which I absolutely love, how appropriate it would be this morning. 'Tis winter now, the fallen snow. Our responsive reading is Psalm 32, found on page 642. I will read the odd-numbered verses and you the even, and we will do the sung response where there is an R. And June will play it for us now, and we'll sing it once. Happy are those whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered.
Happy are those to whom God keeps no iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no deceit.
While I kept silence, my body wasted away through my groaning all day long. Then I acknowledged my sin to you, and I did not hide my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to God, and you forgave the guilt of my sin.
Therefore, let all who are faithful offer prayer to you. At a time of distress, the rush of the mighty waters shall not reach them.
You are a hiding place for me. You preserve me from trouble. You surround me with glad cries of deliverance.
I will instruct you and teach you
not be like a horse or a mule without understanding, whose temper must be curbed with bit and bridle, else it will not stay near you.
Many are the torments of the wicked, but steadfast love surrounds those who trust in God.
Be glad in God and rejoice, O righteous, and shout for joy, all you upright in heart. Please be seated. I'd like to invite the children to come forward, and we even have a nice bench for you to sit on. Come join us. Jenna, if you want to join us, you can all come up. I'll put this down. Put this down here. Okay, that's fine. There we are. Good. So I've been thinking about the words, I'm sorry. When do we say I'm sorry? When you hurt someone? Are there other times that we say, I'm sorry? Certainly when we hurt someone or when we have done something we know we shouldn't have done. Sometimes when someone tells us to say, I'm sorry, like your mom or dad, you're not really ready to say, I'm sorry, huh? Or maybe you're not really sorry, like maybe you hit your brother, but your mom didn't notice that he kicked you first. Yes.
So sometimes we're not ready to say we're sorry, but usually when we say I'm sorry, it's because we really do feel kind of bad about something we did. Mostly we say we're sorry to someone like our mom or our dad or a friend, but sometimes we say I'm sorry to God. Can you think of a time when we might say I'm sorry to God? What do you think?
When we do something nobody knows about.
When we do something wrong that nobody knows about. Yes, absolutely. And sometimes we say I'm sorry to God because we know we're part of a whole group of people who aren't doing the best we can, like maybe we're not doing as well as we could with taking care of our planet, which is something I know we all kind of worry about. But when we say we're sorry, something happens. It kind of fixes something that was broken. You know, there was a gap between us and the person that we say we're sorry for. And saying I'm sorry, and then especially if we hear the words I forgive you, it kind of makes us friends again. Have you experienced that sometimes? Yeah. Okay. And also, you know, if you say I'm sorry to your mom and dad, and they say, that's okay, but what might come after that but? Ben?
Like no dessert for a week.
No. Yes, a punishment, like no dessert for a week. And it might also, have you ever heard this? Please don't do that again. Yeah. So when we say I'm sorry to God, God does forgive us and tells us that God loves us, but God also says, you know, please try not to do that again. So I'm talking about this because we're now in the season in the church called Lent. And Lent is a time for thinking about how we don't always live the way God wants us to live or treat each other and our beautiful planet the way God wants us to. So it's kind of a serious time. It's a serious time that leads up to remembering how Jesus died, but it ends with a big celebration on Easter Sunday, when we remember that Jesus came alive again. And on Easter Sunday, there's something special that we do. And I'm going to give you something to remind you of the something special that we do. And David, maybe you could give everyone one of those. So on Easter Sunday, what do we do with these? Ben? We wave them. Yeah, and there's a special time when we wave them. There's a word that goes with waving them. Do you remember what that is? Absolutely. Alleluia. Good for you. Alleluia is a special Easter word. It's a fizzy, excited word, a kind of jumping up and down word, I'm so happy I can't stand it word. And because Lent is sort of a serious I'm sorry time, we put away the alleluia during Lent. We don't sing it, we don't say it. It's one of those kind of funny church things. And so I'm going to ask you to put your alleluia ribbons in the box, and they will go away until Easter Sunday when they'll come out again. And now we'll sing you off to Sunday school.
That was a great lesson for us children of all ages, and it has me thinking about this passage from Genesis, which is the Hebrew scripture reading this morning. If Adam and Eve had said, "I'm sorry," would God have kicked them out? Anyway, this is from Genesis chapter 2, verses 15 to 17, and chapter 3, verses 1 to 7. Listen for what the reading may be saying to you. God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to till it and keep it. And God commanded the man, "You may freely eat of every tree of the garden, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, you shall not eat. For in the day that you eat it, you shall die." Now the serpent was more crafty than any other wild animal that God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God say, 'You shall not eat from any tree in the garden?'" The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat of the fruit of the trees in the garden, but God said, 'You shall not eat of the fruit of the tree that is in the middle of the garden, nor shall you touch it, or you shall die.'" But the serpent said to the woman, "You will not die, for God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was to be desired to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate, and she also gave some to her husband, who was with her, and he ate. Then the eyes of both were opened, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made loincloths for themselves. So ends the reading.
Thank you, Susan. This is our time for sharing prayer, joys, and concerns. If you have a joy or a concern you'd like to share, please raise your hand and the mic will come to you. And I see Susie has her hand up.
First, I'd like to thank everybody in here who's been so kind to Goddard and me. This has been a long time. Wednesday, I go for surgery. And if that works out, then two or three weeks later, I go for another surgery. We found out that my replacement knee was the wrong one they put in, and I have to have it redone. So that's why I'm kind of crippling around. But I want to thank you for sharing all the things you have with us. For years, Goddard and I have tried to help other people, but we never really learned how to let other people help us. And thank goodness when I'm in a hospital, Goddard will be well taken care of, because so many of you have furnished soup, and he's going to be running away with it. But anyway, thank you very much. I so appreciate all of that. And I hope to see you soon.
Thank you, Susie. We wish you all the best in your surgeries and quick healing. Tim.
I'd like to have prayers for all of those involved in the serious assault that occurred at the Transit Center on Monday evening. Many, many lives were affected by that, and some people's lives will never be the same. So if we can pray for all of those involved in that, it would be appreciated.
Katie.
I would like two sets of prayers, one for my dear friend's mother who fell a little over a week ago on the ice, broke her leg in three places, and had surgery on Friday. So if we could keep Vicky in our prayers. And Calvin broke his arm on Friday night in a hockey game. So if you could all help me pray for him as he's so far away, I would really appreciate it. Thanks.
Long distance mothering is very hard. Well, pray for Calvin and for your friend's mother. Yes, Susan.
I'd like to ask prayers once again for my brother Scott. Every time he turns around, some other part of his body has illness. In the process of being evaluated before a spine surgery, his EKG was abnormal. And it's apparent that he's had a heart attack since August, God knows when. Between COVID and other things, I guess he just didn't notice. But he's having a cardiac catheterization, I believe on Thursday, it's March 2nd. So prayers for Scott and his heart and the whole rest of his body and his wife, Joan, who's a saint.
Prayers for Scott and for Joan. Diana.
Prayers for Georgia. As we have prayed before, Georgia's condition continues to lessen, so we'd like to keep our arms wrapped tightly around the Reed family. Also, prayers for many, many members of our community who are not able to be with us today.
Yes. Thank you, Diana. Anna.
Thank you. I have two prayers today. I'm very grateful to be able to be with you all today. It was a very rough couple weeks at my work. We had a case that was really upsetting for everybody and resulted in a lot of enduring of bites and a lot of aggression, and a lot of the staff were really severely affected by that. So prayers for all the staff and, of course, for the child in question, that they get the help that they need. And prayers for my parents that are traveling in Hawaii. They're probably a lot warmer than we are right now, so I'm a little jealous. But most of all, prayers of the greatest joy that my sister Sophia and her husband are expecting their first baby.
Oh,
so great joy for that. It's a boy, and he'll be due in August. So great joy for that.
That's wonderful. Thank you, Anna.
Dana, and then Catherine.
The last couple of weeks, as we've been sort of winding down in Black History Month, I've been looking at a lot of the history that we share in this country with having brought so many here to this country against their will and for so many years. Basically giving them the short end of the stick, and still that happens. I also can't seem to avoid looking in any direction where around the world people are really suffering in Brazil, in Syria, in Turkey, in the Ukraine. And I think, what should I do? What have I not done? What have we not done that so many in so many places are suffering so much? And it leaves me baffled and saddened and guilty and wondering what should come, what should happen.
Thank you, Dana. Yes, that's such a difficult question. Catherine.
Prayers for Jess and Brooke and the family who are recovering from COVID. And others in the church, I believe, also are struggling with that. And second, Tim and I are headed to Colorado on Wednesday to have a week with three of the children. So traveling mercies for all of them and for us.
Thank you, Catherine. Yes, safe travels. Becca.
Two prayers. One, continued prayers for the people in Turkey and Syria, where the earthquake hit was very close to where Earl and I lived for 2.5 years. And we've thankfully heard from all the people that we know that they're safe and their families are safe. But they know of many who were either perished or are now, you know, living in tents and having trouble getting their basic needs met. So, and then also a little over a week ago, one of Duncan's really close friends, his grandfather, passed away. He leaves a big hole in his family and the community. So.
Thank you, Becca. Yes, pray for Duncan's friend and his family, and for Syria and Turkey. Any others this morning? Please join me then in prayer. Holy One, you created us to be in loving relationship with you and with each other. Because we are so deeply connected with you and one with another in this beloved community and in our world, we share each other's joys and sorrow. We pray with gratitude for those things in our lives that bring us joy, the kindness of the community, being here, a new baby on the way. We pray with concern for those among us who are suffering, those facing upcoming surgeries, those who are so stressed by the stress of children and people who are in crisis, for broken bones, for those facing the end of life, for those mourning someone who has died, for the pain of Black history in this country, and for the suffering in our world. In the beyond us, near us, and within us that is you, we are grateful that our prayers are heard and make a difference in our lives. And now we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Mother, Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Freely, freely we have received. Freely, freely give. We'll now take up our morning offering.
Thank you.
Loving God, you have given yourself to us in every generation, showing us how to give of ourselves to others. We ask you to behold in these offerings our willingness to seek the faithful way of life. Help us to be generous and committed in the discipleship to which you have called us, through your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Our hymn of preparation is number 211, Lord Jesus, who through 40 days. Please be seated.
Thanks. This morning's gospel reading is from Matthew chapter 4, verses 1 to 11. Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. He fasted 40 days and 40 nights, and afterwards he was famished. The tempter came to him and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread." But he answered, "It is written, one does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him to the holy city and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, God will command his angels concerning you, and on their hands they will bear you up so that you will not dash your foot against a stone." Jesus said to him, "Again it is written, do not put the Lord your God to the test." Again the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. And he said to him, "All these I will give you if you will fall down and worship me." Jesus said to him, "Away with you, Satan, for it is written, worship God and serve only God." Then the devil left him, and suddenly angels came and waited on him. Thus ends the scripture.
hear this prayer by Thomas Becon, whose dates were 1511 to 1567. Lord God, we ask for your grace so that we would not just hear your word, but also do it. So that we would not just love your good news, but also live it. So that we would not just enjoy your good teaching, but follow it. So that we would not just know your commandments, but practice them to the glory of your holy name and for the health of our souls. Amen. There are two creation stories at the beginning of the Bible, each written by a different author, and both based on the creation stories of earlier cultures in the ancient Near East. Our Hebrew scripture reading this morning comes from the second creation story. God has created a beautiful garden and placed in it the man God has created, telling him, "You may freely eat of every tree of the garden, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat. For in the day that you eat of it, you shall die." The story goes on to describe the creation of woman from the man's rib, a story we women love to hate, to be the man's partner. And then we come to the second part of our reading. It seems that there is a serpent in the garden. And this wily snake rather disingenuously asks the woman, "Is there any fruit of any tree in the garden that you have been told not to eat?" She says, "Yes, the tree in the middle of the garden. If we eat from that one, we'll die." But the serpent slyly hisses, "You won't die. Instead, your eyes will be opened. You'll be like God, knowing good and evil." The woman looks at the fruit of the forbidden tree, and boy, it smells good and it looks really delicious. And becoming like God sounds like a great idea. So what happens next is pretty inevitable. She eats the fruit and gives some to the man, who eats it too, and bam, they become self-conscious. They realize that they are naked and grab fig leaves to hide what they now see as their private parts. Our reading ends there, but here's the rest of the story. The man and the woman hear God walking in the garden and they hide themselves. God asks, "Why are you hiding? Did you eat from the tree I told you not to touch?" Demonstrating that humankind has been passing the buck right from the get-go, the man whines, "She made me do it." The woman passes the buck on to the serpent. "He tricked me." And God curses all three of them. They are expelled from the garden, the man to labor all his life scratching food from an unrewarding soil, the woman to suffer in childbirth and be ruled by her husband, another part we love to hate, and the snake to crawl on its belly in the dust, bearing unremitting enmity and abuse. Because the writers of Hebrew scripture were primarily concerned with the relationship between God and humankind, this is what is emphasized in the creation stories. In the first story, the creation of humanity in God's image is the crowning act. In the second story, God first makes a human being and then creates all that humans need to sustain life just for their benefit. So here we have a quandary for the early scripture writers. God is all powerful, and God's goodness cannot be questioned. So God must have created a beautiful and perfect world. God created humankind to enjoy this perfect world and filled it with plants that are pleasant to look at and good to eat. everything was wonderful, and no one suffered and died. But that's not the way life is anymore. Life is hard. People do suffer and die. And some of the plants and animals God created, like the serpent, do us harm. So how do we reconcile the goodness of creation and the good God desired for us in creation with the reality of life as we experience it now? Here's where we get to what became known as the fall. For our world to be so different from the paradise God created, the early theologians reasoned, the first humans must have done something wrong. They must have done something so terrible that the only possible response on God's part was to banish them and all of humankind from paradise forever. And that something terrible, they reasoned, was disobedience. The first humans were willful. They wanted to be like God. And this original sin has stained humankind ever since. That's the traditional interpretation. But is this the only way to read this story? Here's another possibility from Rabbi Lawrence Kushner, who sees in the Garden of Eden story not a tale of sin and fall, but an archetypal story of the separation we all must experience in order to become autonomous adults. Kushner writes, if God didn't want Adam and Eve to eat fruit from the tree in the center of the garden, then why put it there, out in the middle of the garden where Adam and Eve could reach it? Why didn't God just hide the fruit somewhere deep in the forest? And then, equally puzzling, after putting the tree right there in the middle of the garden, why did God specifically tell Adam and Eve to be sure not to eat the fruit? What a different world it would be if the forbidden fruit were on one unknown random tree hidden deep in some primordial garden. The chances are high that we might never have discovered it. We would all live in childhood eternal. Kushner goes on to tell of a rabbinic tradition which proposes that God created and destroyed other worlds before our present universe, each one presumably deficient in some vital way. The kids are coming back in. They have something they're going to do, but I will maybe... For all we know, God did try creating a world without the tree temptingly planted right in the middle of the garden, he writes. Or maybe there was a prior universe in which God neglected to forbid human beings to eat the fruit. Maybe God realized that Adam and Eve weren't clever enough on their own to figure out how to sin. After universes of infantile obedience, they remained tediously, predictably, and incorrigibly infantile. Yes, Daddy, yes, Mommy, whatever you want. This will never work, reasons God. Better they should know some sin, estrangement, and guilt, but at least become autonomous human beings, rather than remain these insipid, goody-two-shoes infants. We'll let the kids come in now. But God couldn't just make humans autonomous. In order for their autonomy to be genuine, they had to earn it themselves. I suspect it was for this reason, out of desperation, Kushner writes, that God resorted to a setup, that has come to be known as the expulsion from the Garden of Eden. Eating the first fruit was not a sin, but a necessary prearranged passage toward human maturity. We have read it all wrong. God was not angry. God rejoiced at our disobedience and then wept with joy that we could feel our estrangement and want to return home. What Adam and Eve did in the garden was what was supposed to happen. And it goes on happening as, in Kushner's words, children disobey their parents and in so doing complete their own creation. Adam and Eve are duped not by the snake but by God. They were lovingly tricked into committing the primal act of disobedience that alone could ensure their separation from God, their individuation, and their expulsion from childhood's garden. In this reading of the story, the primordial separation is not only necessary but good. It's what God wants for us. And the price of separation, having to earn our living by our own toil, the physical and emotional pain of bearing and rearing children who will then need to separate from us, and the realization that there are things in the world like the serpent that can hurt us, this price is all part of autonomous adulthood. So here we have two very different understandings of the creation story. In one, disobedience toward God is the worst possible offense we can commit, and only perfect obedience, which we can never hope to attain, will mend our separation from God. This was Adam's sin, which could only be rectified by the perfect obedience of Jesus. In the other, God sets us up to disobey in order to make us grow up. God is all about mutuality of relationship rather than obedience, and finds it far more interesting to relate to autonomous adults than to goody-two-shoes infants. One of my favorite books, one I have reread several times, always finding some new wisdom, is a profound and lovely book titled Learning to Fall. Its author, Philip Simmons, was an English professor who at the age of 35 was diagnosed with ALS, a degenerative condition also known as Lou Gehrig's disease. Learning to Fall became, for Simmons, a metaphor for the terrible and beautiful lessons of living mindfully as he approached his mortality. In explaining the title, he describes his earliest memory. I'm standing alone at the top of the stairs, looking down, scared. I call for my mother, but she doesn't come. I grip the banister and look down. I have never done this on my own before. 40 years later, encroaching baldness has made it easier to see the scars I gained from that adventure. Still, I don't regret it. One has to start somewhere. Is not falling as much as climbing our birthright? In the Christian theology of the fall, we all suffer the fall from grace, the fall from our primordial connectedness with God. My little tumble down the stairs was my own expulsion from the garden. Ever after, I have been falling down, forward and down, into the scarred years of conscious life, falling into the knowledge of pain, grief, and loss. Like Kushner, Simmons believes that falling is inevitable. We will all be expelled from the garden, expelled into the knowledge of good and evil, into the scarred years of conscious life. Simmons writes, we have no choice but to fall, and little say as to the time or the means. What we do have some say in, though, is how we respond to our falling. And how we fall gives us the opportunity to express our essential humanity, our autonomous adulthood. We can fight our falling. We can be bitter about our falling. We can rail against it and shout, "Why is life so crummy?" or "Why me?" Or we can accept the idea, as Simmons does, that life is not a problem to be solved, but a mystery, to which we fully, consciously hand ourselves over. Through learning to fall, we become more fully human, more fully ourselves, more fully connected to others, more fully open to God. Think of falling as a figure of speech, Simmons writes. We fall on our faces. We fall for a joke. We fall for someone. We fall in love. In each of these falls, what do we fall away from? We fall from ego. We fall from our carefully constructed identities, our reputations, our precious selves. We fall from ambition. We fall from grasping. We fall, at least temporarily, from reason. And what do we fall into? We fall into passion, into terror, into unreasoning joy. We fall into humility, into compassion, into emptiness, into oneness with forces larger than ourselves, into oneness with others, whom we realize are likewise falling. We fall at last into the presence of the sacred, into godliness, into mystery, into our better, diviner selves. I'm with Kushner. I think there's a reason God put the tree of the knowledge of good and evil right in the middle of the garden, where Adam and Eve couldn't miss it. God wants to be in relationship with autonomous adults whose better, diviner natures are being shaped by fully embracing our imperfect human lives. So don't be afraid to fall. We can't avoid it, but we can choose to allow our inevitable falls to bring us into the presence of the sacred, into godliness, into mystery, into our better, diviner natures. Amen. It just happened, though I didn't plan it that way, that the Sunday school lesson was very much like the lesson that I did for children. And they have done something special. And I'm going to ask David to just briefly describe it, and then perhaps during our closing hymn, the children can do the action that they were going to do. So.
So I apologize for the disruption. I can never get the timing of church just right when it's going to end.
Neither can I, David.
So we talked about apologizing and forgiveness, and we introduced confession in Sunday school this morning, and we had a story that we went through, and the kids did a terrific job talking about forgiveness, apologizing, and how to make our apologies meaningful. And so as we introduced praying and forgiving, getting forgiveness with God, we did a short exercise where we have what we call the confession box or the apology box, where we wrote down something that we want to have forgiveness for, something that's weighing heavily on us. We wrote those things down on a piece of paper. We folded them up tightly. We put them in the box, and we are going to release them into our wood stove and share them with God, ask for meaningful apologies and forgiveness, and hopefully we'll try to lighten our hearts with that.
So I'm going to invite you, while we're singing our hymn, to come up and release these things that were heavy on your hearts into the stove and send them to God. Our hymn is number 558, "Oh, How Glorious, Full of Wonder."
If you would enter into the wilderness, do not begin without a blessing. Do not leave without hearing who you are, beloved, named by the one who has traveled this path before you. Do not go without letting it echo in your ears, and if you find it is hard to let it into your heart, do not despair. That is what this journey is for. I cannot promise this blessing will free you from danger, from fear, from hunger or thirst, from the scorching of sun or the fall of the night. But I can tell you that on this path there will be help. I can tell you that on this way there will be rest. I can tell you that you will know the strange graces that come to our aid only on a road such as this, that fly to meet us bearing comfort and strength, that come alongside us for no other cause than to lean themselves toward our ear, and with their curious insistence, whisper our name. Beloved, beloved, beloved. Amen. And that was in the words of Jan Richardson. And please sit now for the postlude. Now, beloved, jump up and greet one another.